We're joined by our buddy, Connor O'Gara. What's up, Connor?
You know, I feel like I should say coming on that I just want to hug an Aggie fan every time I look back at this projection that you were just talking about there, because for the sake of everyone listening to this, hopeful that this can be the year to get over the hump, to beat Bama, to get to an SEC championship, this would be the most painful possible result. And for your sake, I really hope that it doesn't play out this way.
Well, yeah, let's kind of get into it, because I think last year, and in fact, when I'm looking at some of the notes, you said you were dead wrong about the Aggies last year. So yeah. Let's start with that. What were you wrong about?
I brought up this stat before. I did not like the belief that A&M was instantly going to get better just based on the schedule. And I didn't like putting them in the top 10 to come into the season, because the stat that I kept bringing up was in 2019, they played 300 minutes of football against teams that finished in the AP top 15, and they led for 7 minutes and 42 seconds of that time. That is not an elite team. And what they did last year at the start of the year, I'm like, look, you're seeing it. You see the struggles against Vandy. You see the second half against Alabama. And I'm like, look, this team is not on that level. And then they were. And then they figured it out. And they were absolutely an elite team. And by the end of the year, I'm banging the drum that they were more deserving of getting into the college football playoff than Notre Dame. That's how things can change when you have things built the right way. So I was dead wrong thinking that they had that type of upside. I was sort of out on Jimbo Fisher as one of these top five coaches in all of college football. But the adjustments that they made, especially with some of the injuries that they had at the pass catcher positions, I thought they just did a tremendous job of figuring out who they were and being able to beat teams week in, week out, and impose their will in a very 2010-like way. And I think that A&M moving forward, it has totally changed my perception of them, and that's why I have them with a higher ceiling going into this year than I did last year.
All right, so you didn't think Jimbo was a top five coach before, at least in this world of college football. Now you do see him in that. Are you saying that you've grown from that opinion and because of the proof he's done there in College Station?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that if he wouldn't have succeeded last year, you got to think about this. You would be looking at four consecutive years in which you'd say, is Jimbo kind of wasting this opportunity? Is he wasting the resources that he's had at two different places and not maximizing it? Because year three, you know, the majority of that roster is now his, and you kind of can't really use that as an excuse. It's kind of up to you. You haven't had the turnover at the coordinator position, so you can't point to that. You've had the ability to develop a quarterback, a former blue chip guy, and Kellen Mond. So I would have looked at those things and said, you know what? No, I don't even think that you could have put Jimbo Fisher in the top 10 coaches in college football if he had had some 7-5 type of season last year. But that wasn't the case. And he took A&M to a place that really it hadn't been in the post-Johnny Manziel era, and I thought that he deserved a lot of credit for that.
I got to just ask you a question. What about Jimbo's first year at A&M? I understand his second year where they won 8 games was a disappointing year, but that first year where they won 9, coming back from what was a down year with Sumlin, was that not a good enough year? Or you're saying because if you're in that top five category, 9 wins isn't enough?
Exactly. That's it. That's what we're talking about here. And I think that he might not have been set up to succeed year one where he's competing the same way that he did last year in 2020. But I still kind of looked at that and said, all right, that's about probably what I expected. I thought he did some really nice things with Kellen Mond. And if you look back at the 2017 version of Kellen Mond and compare it to 2018, you saw from the jump that he was a better, more developed quarterback. So I think he deserved credit for that. I thought it was pretty standard for the most part. And I know, you know, this is a long argument that A&M and LSU fans have been having, the 7 overtime game, a couple of the balls that bounced A&M's way instead of LSU. When you kind of break that down, you say, well, if it had gone this way, then what kind of season are we really looking at for A&M? So, like, you get into things like that, and the lack of competitiveness against a team like Alabama is always going to be the measuring stick. That's what Jimbo Fisher came to A&M to do, was to take A&M to a level that Alabama is at. Now, that is way easier said than done, but fair or not, that is how he's going to be judged moving forward. It's going to be about whether or not he can win an SEC championship, whether or not he can get to the playoff, not just once, but to do it, you know, year after year. That's the standard when you pay a coach $75 million guaranteed.
Connor O'Gara on the BCSI hotline. All right, I want to get to the predictions and the way you've navigated the season, but before that, you put a note about A&M being knocked at times for being a throwback team. Should they be knocked? Because college football is evolving, obviously, and is becoming more of an aerial attack. That being said, you win in the fourth quarter, and Jimbo was able to do that with that ground and pound and that defense.
And I remember watching games last year where you would hear the announcers talk about A&M, like, they have to stretch the field. They simply have to stretch the field. And I'm looking at the score. It's like, well, it's 21-7. They've held time of possession. They've been in total control of this game. Do they really have to take a shot downfield? I don't know. I think what they're doing is working. And I think obviously the loss of Caleb Chapman hurt the ability to do that. And having him back this year, you would think that even if Haynes King isn't quite all the things that Kellen Mond was, that he should have a better chance of being able to stretch the field. But I think they were hurt to a certain regard. And I think in this day and age in college football, where, you know, even in the SEC, it's all about the receiver, it's all about the quarterback. And that's just the way that we're wired now. And when teams like Alabama and LSU are doing it one way, yeah, you get knocked for not being that specific team. Georgia's been knocked for not doing it that specific way. And I think now all the talk and all the buzz about Georgia is, well, now they have the quarterback, they have the offensive coordinator, they have the system to be able to execute that modern offense that we're used to seeing with being able to spread teams out vertically. And I think that A&M was sort of held back in the national regard because, in part, the fact that they couldn't stretch the field the way that certain other teams could. And because this in 2021 is just what our eyes are used to seeing, and they were doing it differently.
All right, Connor, let's talk a little bit about that that road that you saw. It's funny because there's a part to get excited about. You have them be, and again, people have opinions, right? You're allowed to have an opinion, right? You think they're going to win, they're going to lose. It's just an opinion. But you have them going 10-2, beating Alabama, but losing to Arkansas and losing to LSU, if I remember correctly. Just kind of tell us how you got there.
Well, that'd be a roller coaster. And I hope A&M fans have a strong stomach and they'd be able to get through that, because you would start off SEC play with a loss to Arkansas that, you know, we're talking about a decade long streak now. And 7 of these 9 games have been decided by 12 points or less. I think Arkansas fans are hoping that this can finally be the year. And given what they have on defense, the thing that worries me about that game for A&M is what Barry Odom is going to be able to throw at a first-time starting quarterback. And you saw last year kind of the Matt Corral game where he really struggled against that drop eight coverage, and it was just a disaster. And I think that Barry Odom, with the veterans that he has on that defense, can disguise some of those looks and throw a lot of different things at a first-time starting quarterback. So I see potential struggles there. I think the secondary is able to get a couple of these key turnovers. And finally, this is a breakthrough type of game for Arkansas. But I still have A&M beating Alabama. And I think this is finally the year that this happens. And I said that, you know, last time that I was on here, and how I think that the secondary lines up really well. If Mike Elko wants to try and only have 4 guys rush the passer, this is an A&M secondary that I think is built to handle this better than they have been in years past. And they have the dudes up front to compete with Alabama at the line of scrimmage. And that's been the big thing kind of holding them back at some of these key moments. And I think that in that atmosphere, which is just going to be second to none, there might not be a better atmosphere in all of college football than the one that you're going to see on October 9th in College Station. And I think that against Bryce Young proves to be a little bit too much. And I think that A&M is able to win that game. And then, man, if they were able to control their own destiny and have that regular season finale against LSU where everything is on the line, SEC West title, you know, playoff berth potentially hanging in the balance, and going into Death Valley, man, I saw LSU play spoiler last year with a team that for the most part really didn't act like it had any interest in playing football in 2020. I mean, with all the opt-outs and the transfers, it was just a weird year for LSU. But if A&M were to get to that game and have to go into Death Valley, I think that they would really relish the opportunity to play spoiler and to play in this back-and-forth type of game that I think that you would look at Max Johnson, and I think his ability to rise to the occasion, his understanding of reading coverages and what he could potentially be at the end of the season could be the difference in a game like that. But like I said, man, I hope Aggie fans don't have to experience that, because that would be the most bittersweet type of season, in the regular season at least, to have to experience.
So let me ask you this. Let's pretend that this happens, right? How does the narrative change? If Jimbo does beat Alabama, how does that changed the way A&M is looked at and the way Jimbo's looked at. That being said, with those two losses, though, like, A&M found a way to mess it up, or had they broken through at least from the way they were perceived?
You know, in a way, it's strange, but I think A&M can do more to help its national brand with that projection than this past year, because it's all about Bama. If you can beat Bama, if you're Jimbo, you become the first Saban assistant to take down the master. Man, people talk about that. And with Texas coming into the conference, that is the ultimate sign of, hey, we can compete. We have the athletes to be able to do this. We now have the personnel to do something that hasn't been done before. And I think that A&M is in position now where people are waiting to see A&M fall off. People want to point to 2020 and say, you know what? They had this veteran offensive line, you know, the pandemic. They were really kind of built to handle that. They had continuity up front that most programs weren't able to have. And that's really where they benefited. A&M's going to go back to kind of being this 8-win team, maybe 9-win team. And I think there are a lot of people waiting for A&M to sort of fail. And this year, if they were to have an SEC West title path paved by beating Alabama, that would say so much to the college football world, because they would still end up getting in a New Year's Six bowl game. They would still have a chance for a potential top five finish, all those different things. And doing that in consecutive years, I mean, Bear Bryant didn't even have consecutive top 5 years at A&M. That would matter, and that would be a loud statement to the college football world.
All right, we are focusing on Anaya Smith on our 21 and 21, where we're breaking down the best 21 players on A&M. We're at number four. Just to your thoughts on the game changer, the mismatches that Anaya presents.
I think he's the third best player in A&M, so I'll disagree with you on that. Okay. Just with Kenyon Green, DeMarvin Leal as the only two guys ahead of him. But I love Anaya Smith. I really do. And I came to appreciate his game last year. And, you know, one of my former coworkers, Michael Bratton, told me coming into the season, if there's a guy that we're sleeping on in the SEC, it's Anaya Smith. And the hybrid role that he sort of carved out for himself, you know, we tend to think of some of these guys who can catch passes out of the backfield as just these kind of scat backs. And that really doesn't do his role justice, because what he's going to be able to do out of the slot and to make people miss in the open field is special. And I included him as one of my top 25 overall players in the SEC. That's offense, defense, you know, regardless of position. I think he's that dude. And I think he gives you a different element on offense. And for a first-time starting quarterback, he is going to become such a safety valve for this offense. And I cannot wait to see what he's able to do with a full year of getting those regular reps, and maybe a little bit more of an entrenched role, I think could benefit him, where he doesn't necessarily have to take on some of the carries they did last year with Spiller and A-Chain, kind of solidifying that backfield as a really good 1-2 punch. But I'm excited to see him. I think he's got all SEC potential for sure. And I think that anybody that's discounting his role in this offense is probably just not watched him play football enough.
Hey, Connor, I know you got another hit coming up, so let me just ask you this last question. Your thoughts on the alliance, you know, is it going to mean something? Is it just a strategy for now? Well, how do you see this whole alliance working out?
I get it. I get it from a scheduling standpoint, to a certain extent, of saying we need to probably join forces instead of trying to fight Greg Sankey individually. Sorry about that. But we look at this from the outside and from the SEC perspective, and you say, well, you're missing out on playoff revenue if you're delaying expansion. And that's the dumbest thing to me that I'll never understand. If the Pac-12 and ACC and Big Ten truly think that they're going to slow down the SEC's rise, that's comical to me, because you're looking at a conference that's won 11 of the last 15 national championships. They've won 4 of the 7 in the playoff era. The SEC doesn't need to expand. They don't need the playoff expansion. It's those other conferences that need that. So from that standpoint, I don't really get it. But at the same time, if I'm Kevin Warren, I would rather have a couple of people on my side when I have those meetings with Greg Sankey, because I still think Greg Sankey is the most powerful person in college football. He's going to have a massive say in the future of this sport. And if those three conferences feel that they're best at kind of being able to be on the same group text and set up all these matchups and do that, then by all means, do what you got to do for your brand. But SEC is still king.
Connor, I appreciate you, brother. Take care, my friend.
Appreciate it, man.
All right, take care.